Suelo. ¿Cuál es el suelo?
Difícil.
Sí, no.
Sí.
No.
Ok.
No, no, no.
Ok, ¿usted explica así? Ok. So, if you hear a horn, you're a musician?
Not much.
Not much means what?
I mean, I play the flute, but I...
Oh, then you're in trouble. Then you and I cannot actually perceive. We have a problem. We have a conditional problem. But if you can just forget that for a second. You just hear one. Why horn? You just hear one. Beep, beep. Sound, right? That's a frequency. But is that a swara?
No, swara is...
No, no, I'm asking him. He's, I'm, no, no, I come to you later. But I want to finish.
No. Any frequency is not a swara.
But you said swara is...
Ah, okay. Swara is a frequency.
Okay, very nice. Okay, you're saying swara is a frequency. But any frequency is not a swara. Okay, I'll detail that too, but later.
No,
okay.
You're saying swara is an ordered pair of...
Swara is an ordered pair of frequencies. So, okay. Why are you saying it's an ordered pair?
You don't have any sarangas.
Forget about sarangas. without reference to sarangas, tell me what is order about it.
No, I'm saying how much this differs, this frequency differs from that.
What means sound?
So that's only perception, no?
Sound which is space.
That's only perception, no? If you have two sounds with a different interval between them, which you don't perceive it as deep, for example, and you go deep, then is it not a swara? In Turkish music, in one octave, they play what? Is that 50 notes or 56 notes or 53 notes or something, right?
Iranian
music. Turkish music, they play 53 notes. You and they will never recognize it. They actually call them notes. Microphone points that they play in between when they play. To them, all of them are notes, but they don't refer, you and I will not refer to as a swara, right? When you listen to it, you only refer to those that you see as he as well. So I'm playing devil's advocate. So I'm just going to try and keep questioning what we're thinking to see if we can come with more clarity. If I can come back with more clarity than I have. So, anything else? Any other swara? So swara is a frequency, but all frequencies are not a swara. That's what she said.
Is it some basic notes upon which something is built?
Okay, basic notes. Anything else?
Relative position.
Relative position, very close to what he said. Yeah. So the perception of swara is also cultural. You agree? If we take the definition that swara is a frequency, I'm going to come with that first definition. I'm going to go with it for a while, but then I'm going to try and break that definition. But till I go with it, let's go with it. That swara is a frequency, but it is also a cognitively recognized frequency as a note. You agree? It's cognition. You cognitively recognize it. That's why it becomes a swara. If you don't cognitively recognize it, it's not a swara. It could be sound of a horn. Now, for example, the problem, for example, you take me as a musician, any note comes, immediately my mind will make a knee, da, something. Okay? It's just instinct. I mean, I don't even have to think. The moment you say, sir, sir, I just did this in a second without even thinking. Why? Because I'm cognitively immediately associating it with that idea. So there is a cultural aspect to it. But the fact is, if we define swara as a position, then it is a position that is also being recognized. Now, how is it recognized? How is it recognized? We have to bring in one more idea here, if you have to look at it. He said two pairs, two free pairs.
Ordered
pairs. Two ordered pairs. Okay, I'm going to go with that one. In which case, we are also talking about the idea of that fact that it is, there's an idea of an octave note.
An origin.
Huh?
You mean the place where the start.
Yeah. So you're looking at an octave. So the moment you place it, or I mean, this part was thing, but then you're also placing it within the idea of an octave. Okay. The moment you say swara, you're giving it recognition as being something more than frequency. It's ri ga ma. But if you say ri ga ma, you're automatically saying that it is bound or it is between the interval of one octave to another. Right. So in saying swara, you're saying a lot of things. You're not just saying sound. The moment you use the word swara, you are saying a lot of things that's implied. that you cognitively recognize. Now technically all this are just pieces of sound, right? They're just one horn, me singing a sa, somebody is playing the vina, all the same, it's just sound. But we are implying with the word swara that it has a character beyond being sound, it has a musical context, and we are also saying that it has an octave context. And we are saying that. So the word swara does say more than this. I believe it says even more than this, but we'll come to that in another part. Okay, next word. I don't know how many people heard this. Okay, I'm going to come to that word later, but I'm going to go to the word gamaka. Again, everybody has heard this. Anybody who's heard Carnatic music or Indian classical music, or mainly Carnatic music, will say, fully gamaka. So much gamaka. So heavy gamaka. These are all classic phrases, you know. And all musicians the same. Number music, sir. Heavy, sir. Full of gamaka. Yeah, I always wondered, okay, what's so heavy about it? I mean, it's, you can't lift it, can you? I mean, actually, look at it. You don't lift it. So how do you know it's heavy and light? Actually, it's interesting how an oral perception actually gives you a physical manifestation, how we express it, right? It's completely something you hear, but you perceive it as being heavy or light, which are all actually physical manifestations of being heavy or light. That itself is intriguing, right? how we place it like that. But it obviously triggers something in our brain that makes us manifest it with those words, because we experience the words. I can tell you when I say it's heavy and I think of a ragam, I actually feel it's heavy. I do. When I say todi, I think it's heavy. But then I look at it and say, what is heavy about it? There's nothing heavy about it, but it's heavy. You know, so, gamaka. What's the gamaka?
Oscillation.
Come on. All the standard words, come on, let's get that out first. Accent. Oscillation. Huh? Come on, there's one more word.
Emphasis,
stress.
Progression. From one note to another.
Progression from one note to another. So if you don't progress from one note to another, there's no gamaka?
One
note or one swara?
One swara.
So you can't have gamaka in one swara without moving to another swara? So you're considering itself also. Okay, fine. Is it possible to have a gamaka and not go back to its swara? Meaning, I start a swara, I go to a gamaka, but I don't come back to the swara. I just drop it. Then what is happening? Is it possible? That's what I'm saying. I start a swara, I sing an oscillation or whatever you may call it, but I'm not going to the next swara, which is two paired, how you define it. But I'm not coming back to the swara. Then what happens? Is it still gamaka? Not necessary. I can tell you, we do that in Carnatic music too. Anything else?
Sample
thing, explain that to me.
This was
scientifically very
handicapped.
Yeah, go on. You can explain it
in
English terms.
You have a swara in time scale.
Okay.
Right? It's sample piece of that.
No. Sir, will you agree to that, sir? I really lost it.
Sampled piece of a swara.
Is that a gamaka? He's asking. No, right? You can't look at it that way.
Like provocation. I think.
No, you can't. If you're looking at any swara and trying to sample it out and say it's a gamaka. No, that's not right. It's a characteristic, which I agree. The pulling of a swara. There's one word I'm missing. I'm just hoping somebody will say it.
Is it a vibrato?
Shaking, oscillation, creativity. Well, that's debatable. We'll come to that.
Is it something?
So just tell me what a gamaka is. Don't tell me what it does.
It is a range of frequencies around that midpoint of.
It's a range of frequencies around the midpoint. So,
you want to see oscillation?
I'm going to sing something.
That's what oscillation is.
Oscillation. Is that a gamaka? That's a range of frequencies around ma.
No. It's not.
I sang whatever I could say, I sang, okay? That's range of frequencies around ma. Is that a gamaka?
No.
So that you agree is not a gamaka. So your definition, there's something
flawed. You're not sure.
You're not sure.
And
the continuous
are not discrete.
What?
It is very discrete.
So it's a continuous range of frequencies. frequency is around the swara?
Around 20 will be and all that.
Okay.
Is it going back between, there is a basic swara, and you're lingering around that swara, but not saying that swara, like you just said mama mama, you're not saying that, but you're like stretching it around it.
So can I just quickly put some of the points that came? One, it's a range of frequencies, or you say continuous range of frequencies. You said you are not actually saying that note.
But you're lingering around that.
But you're lingering around that note, which is again another point. Anything else?
An adornment of
adornment. I was hoping somebody would say adornment, ornamentation. Waiting for that. Yeah. I was hoping that. That's the.
Said it actually.
Somebody said ornamentation. I was hoping. You said, I'm sorry, I missed it. Because, yeah, because adornment, ornamentation are the most commonly used phrase. I mean, by not just you, by scholars included. Scholars and musicologists have all used the word ornamentation, oscillation. Oscillation specifies a certain movement. But it's interesting that we say oscillation. Because I will come to the most crucial gamaka in Carnatic music, which is a kind of an oscillation. And the predominance of that oscillation is probably what makes all of us perceive that a gamaka is only oscillation. That's why we generally say it's oscillation. I think that's
especially on the string.
Yeah, and you also visually see it being, but when they do that, they're playing different kinds of gamakas, not necessarily one kind of gamaka. I'm going to just quickly go through the different types of gamakas. Not because breaking it down like this will give you any better understanding. You don't sit in the concert group for every gamaka when you sing next time. Please don't. That's the worst thing you can do. But to just give you that, there is more than just probably an oscillation. Okay? But there are some very nice points I thought that came out. The fact that, for example, some other note is said is, I think, a very, 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 very interesting point that was raised, because it is true that some gamakas move between two swaras, okay, or move from one swara to another, but are only said, articulated as one swara. So basically, when there's a gamaka, one fact is definite, that there is something else happening in between other than what is being articulated. There is some movement in between or in that swara other than what is being articulated. Now, one few examples. I'll go through some of the major expressions that you have. Do you want me to give you the names, or you don't want me to give you? Like, why do you want the names? Do you want the names? Dashi with the Gamakas have nothing to do with what we see today.
That's
not
what
I'm not going. Because Dashi with the Gamakas is again something that is used very, very commonly a lot of times. But if you actually correlate Dashi with the Gamakas and any of them to what we see, they seem like phrases rather than gamakas. Do you agree, sir? If I'm wrong, please correct me. They seem more like phrases. So this whole dashing the gamaka obsession, you have to first, again, another thing you've thrown into the dustbin. There are a lot of things you've thrown in the dustbin, but that's one of the things. Because I think you have to forget about it. Because what we actually sing, some of these gamakas we actually sing. But they are not individual parts of the whole. They are part of a complete continuum. This dashing the gamaka, some of them feature, but some of them are totally not associated with what we do. But we love to, like always, we love to refer to Dashi with Gamaka as being 10 types of Gamakas that we see, but that's not true.
I just have a little question, so I can doubt a lot of things.
Yeah, go ahead.
There's Swaras and Anuswaras. Would they contribute to this Gamaka?
Yeah, they would. I'll come to that. Yeah. And you have to define it for me. Yeah?
Pardon?
You have to define it for me so we can get there. Okay? There's one called gentle, okay, which appears when the same swara is repeated twice, okay. Each of them, one. Sa sa is called gentle. Now, if you hear it, I didn't sing. Sa 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 sa. I said sa sa. So there was a specific intonation on the second sound. The moment I do that, there is an appearance of a glance. I will not say the swara, a glance of another swara appearing. A glance of the knee appears. But knee does not appear. Please be very careful. Knee does not appear, but a glance of the knee appears. It is not perfectly sa, sa, ni, sa, sa, sa. It is a glance of that knee. So which means that it is not me, but yet it is a shadow or a portion of that me that appears in the sun. It has to be perceived like that. If you perceive it, I can tell you as a teacher, there's a big problem. Some people will say, I'll say, sing sa sa de sa 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 sa, they sing that way. So I'll say, no, it's not sa sa, it's sa sa. Can you hear the difference between the two? Sa sa and sa sa. There's actually a difference. The second version, my intonation was on the knee. Sa sa, sa sa. So if you perceive it as being a note, knee being there, you will lose the plot. You have to perceive it as two sa's with an intonation on the second sa, which will automatically give you a shadow of the knee. You don't need to do anything to it. And you know what the colloquial way we'll say in classes, hit it, a more expensive. Adi. Renda the sa, adi. Hit the second sa. Actually, there is nothing hitting about it. You know, but I think these are very interesting things, because if you actually go beyond that expression, you're actually learning from something from that expression. You know? Because sa sa. So they said, stop thinking, just hit the knee. I actually shouted in class, hit the knee, don't think. And they'll get it right. And I still don't know how they do it. I just use it, works. That's how I know it works.
Would they have to then modulate their singing?
Yeah, of course. So this sa sa, there's a difference between the within the sound that produced with the first sa and the second sa. There has to be.
Are you only saying that you are singing the knee for a very much shorter
duration? I am singing it for a shorter duration, probably not also in, if you consider the swara a frequency position, I am not actually probably going to the exact position also. If you put it on a timeline graph, and I've done it, I can tell you when I sing sa sa, I am within the shadow range of that frequency. I am not on that frequency. But you hear it as me.
You can't compare configuration C sa and then make it sing me only for a very short time.
Then it will not sound like this.
It doesn't sound like this.
No, it will never sound like this. If the moment you position it, that's what I said. If you perceive a swara as a frequency point, then you don't go to that frequency point. You go into its range, into somewhere it still sounds. The fact is, in your oral system, you still hear it as me. That's a very important quality that we need to remember when we move this discussion. That means you're not singing actually the knee position as your mathematicians will tell you, or you yourself will tell yourself, but you still hear yourself as singing knee. This is a very important quality of a swara that we need to remember. Then, I'll just move to other ones. There's one called Jaru, which is basically colloquially a sweep.
Jaru.
Jaru. Jaru is, of course, I know it's very close to a Jaru actually. But I didn't mean a Jaru. But it is a sweep.
Okay, the drag.
Niga. When I do this, it's not me. So there is this movement, right? There's a crash. So I am in the process touching upon a lot of frequencies in between, not a lot of movement. Okay? We'll just leave it there. This is Jaru. Then we have something called, for example, what we call Skrutam today. Magari. Ma gari. I'm saying ma, but I'm singing three swarams there. Pa ma ma is what I'm singing. So that's why when you say one swaram is important.
From
sa
to
sa,
supposed
to
be a
jaru.
When
you're
singing
Sankara,
there will be a different jaru and
you'll carry
a different jaru.
The shadows will be different. Slightly. Could be. I'll sing that in marginal show you. Okay? You'll see how it's
Huh? Very good point.
Yeah, very good question. Very, very good question. Because the shadows will be different. Because in your conscience, you have an idea of the track. Let's put it there. You have an idea of the track when you go there.
Then the Turkish classical musicians can recognize these.
Of course, they can. I don't know Turkish music. What do you recognize or not? You have to ask them. But anyway.
They have 53%.
Yeah, approximately. Yeah.
About.
Ma gari, ma ma ma. I'm saying ma. I'm saying pa gari, ma gari, da pa ma gari. This is what we call spuritam today.
Spuritam.
Okay. Spuritam.
Ni or ri?
Spuri, ri.
Ri.
Okay? Then you have something called Kandipu. Now, Kandipu is like pa pa ri ga. And I sing. The roads are pa ri ga. Technically, pa ri ga. You know. Means, but I am singing pa ri ga. There is something in between. Pa ri ga. For a split second, I am just hitting ga. Pa ri pa ri ga. Ga pa ri ga. Okay. But what makes this important is also the way I sing. The accent, the intonation, where the emphasis is different. Now, if the actual note is pa ga ri ga, if I sing pa ri ga, it's different pa ri ga. So the measurement or the time I spend on that intermediary position is also very important.
But in the manner when you do like this kind of thing. For an experienced person like you will not deviate from that main raga that you're singing. But for a student, it's very easy to switch into another raga.
Yeah, good, you have to switch, no? You have to skip. Good. Moving on.
If they say, okay, you are saying it all wrong, you can just say that.
That's how you learn. You have to fall. It's like bicycle. You fall, fucking down, get hurt. Get up and again, find the bike. That's about it. Yeah. Then.
I have a
sorry, can I say this one?
So I have a certain sort of more basic question. So what is this connection with sa, ri, gama? Why those specific words? Are they actually connected to frequency or notes or something?
You mean the word sa, ri, gama, pa, re, ni?
Why should you say sa, ri, gama?
I mean, you relate. Okay, the origin of the words sajjam, rishabham, gandharam, madhyam, that's the full form. Goes to ancient Indian classical music, right up to what, 2nd century AD, sir? Probably. Okay? But the manifestation of it as sa, ri, ga, or say the written form of it. Now, the possibility we can relate it to about, I think, the 6th or 7th century. When you first see actually script being written, one of it is in Pudimiyar Malai, which is in Tamil Nadu. Where you see a script being written where when presented in a musical form, these swaras, sajjam, rishabham, gandharam, were all given as sa, ri, ga, ma, pa, in notation form. That's probably the first instance where you have a notated scene. Then you have a later treatise bringing it down. But it does seem that from the beginning, correct me if I'm wrong, that the notes were probably sung in this devised manner of reducing them as sa, ri, ga, ma, from the beginning. Now, you go further back, you want to look at whether, for example, Samagana and whether what relationship that has.
That question was simple. Yeah. Why do you want to use the word sa?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, why you want,
why
to,
you
use
want
the word?
To use the word sa?
You just made the sa as the second thing in the mix.
Oh, you mean when I sang it, the gamaka?
No, I'm saying what is the specific connection between sa, ri, ga, ma? For the. Why are you not. So you're just saying it's because of the name.
Yes.
The thing is the name of the frequency and it's been short formed.
Yes, that's all. That is your question, right? Or did I get it wrong?
I'm wondering if you can say B. You can sing
you probably can
and make full sense in Carnatic music.
No, yeah, you can probably replace it with any vowels that you want. If you're asking me that, yeah, you can. But you wouldn't.
Okay.
That's a different thing. Yeah, you can probably say ka ti pi ki poo.
Yeah, that's true.
And still sing the same frequency. Ka ti ku. You can sing what you want. Technically, the music is, the melody is one, and you place the melody with a syllabic sound. Now, there's one more aspect that we can't ignore, that there's an association between the syllabic sound that is being uttered and the sound itself. Right? This is an established association. So, between me saying sa and saying ta, there's a difference. Ta, sa, there is actually a difference. Not just conditional difference, but there is a difference in actually the sound body that you are creating. So that we cannot ignore. So when we say sa, ri, ga, ma, pa, whatever we say, it is a holistic form of the sound of the whatever this, the frequency of the swara with a syllabic covering or we are given. Both are together. The sound that you hear is not just an empty sound, but along with the syllable that is attached to the sound. So the removing of these two will actually deconstruct the aesthetic form of that sound. So we should be, that we have to remember when I say you can say ka ta pi tu ku. But ka, singing ka yes, as ka and singing sa are not the same.
True.
Right? Just because it is in the same frequency doesn't make both the same.
You see, for example, it's a very interesting position. The ni and the ri are sort of higher pitches in a way, you know, instead of ga, ma, pa, they seem to be lower in some.
Not musical.
You can have all the notes, sa, ri, ga, ma, pa, da, ni.
Yes,
so the same frequency, no?
No, for example, sa, ri, it's a lower pitch. Ni, ri, same ri on the next octave is a higher pitch. No, that's where the octave comes from.
But
you are talking about vocal, how about instrument? Indian instrumental music, we have to first accept, have to look at different perception than vocal. We have to fact that Indian classical music is a vocal tradition. And right through history, instrumental music has tried to be as close to the voice as possible. This is one fundamental thing we have to accept. Now, we may not like it, we want to break free, that's a totally different discussion. But a fundamental fact is that through history, it is a vocal tradition. It is a vocal tradition and instruments have always tried to sound as close. Now, why do you say the veena is as close to the voice? For example, something everybody says. It's the fact that you are trying some way to sound like the body of sound that the vocal box, the human being can generate. Okay, so this is an intrinsic one. Now, you have few more kamakas. Shall I just skip them quickly?
Yeah.
Skip it?
No.
I said jaru. I said jantri, I said spuritam, and I said kandipu. Four.
Kandipu.
Kandipu is pariga, is another kind. You don't need to know what it is, just listen to it. Try and just listen to it. Pariga, riga, riga, ma, that's spuritam. Okay. Pani ma, this is jaru. Okay. Then you had jantri, sa, sa. Okay. Then you have something called Udukkal, which in many ways may sound similar because it's in the voice, it's more a technique of playing on the veena, is basically how do you say pa, moving to another swara and coming back to it. Any of them can be.
Is it not a slightly miniature version of the drag part?
Exactly.
Not
very good point. Good observation. It is, that's why I said in the voice it doesn't make a difference. In a way it's similar to jaru. Okay? The only difference is you're coming back to the same position. In a jaru you don't necessarily come back. In the voice I'm doing the same thing for both. In the veena, the technique of playing a jaru is very different from taking. In jaru, you move between frets. In udukkal, you're in the same fret and pulling and pulling back. So it is more actually related to the veena playing than singing. In singing, I'm actually doing exactly the same thing. Pani ma pa da pa, I'm doing exactly the same thing. So in the voice, it is not a
difference. Also, when you pull back, pull back and come to
touching
the
floor
and come back to the
same. No, here also I'm doing exactly the same thing. Only thing, the technique of playing a udukkal on the same fret. When you pull the string on the fret, you go to a higher frequency, right? Higher sound. And you go higher swara rather and you come back. When you go between frets also, you can do that. When you do it between frets, it's a jaru. And also without, okay? And when you do the same frets, so it's more a playing technique than anything else. Then we come to the most crucial heavy gamakam of Carnatic music. In my opinion, that defines Carnatic. I mean, this is the sound that is Carnatic sound, okay, called Kampitam. 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 Now, this Kampitam is what makes what we say, Umba Karnataka, heavier part. All that comes from this one sound that we have evolved through the ages. I think it's a brilliant evolution that we could come up with one sound that epitomizes the Carnatic. Classic is Gama. Ni, they're two different things, but still coming down. Ni, ma. This kind of this shake, okay, of this is actually the oscillation, okay, of a note. which need not refer the note itself, okay, and need not be perfectly referring the notes next to it also. There's a famous thing, everything is in context, and this is all in context. It depends on where it is being sung, how it is being sung. But it's pretty much that oscillation that you think a gamaka is. But as you see, among all the gamakas, only one gamaka is actually an oscillation. Like this. This is only kamikara. Any raga that has a lot of this, you will call hiri. You will call hiri. I can give it to you in writing. Any raga that has less of this will be called lek.
Is it because it's difficult to sing, or is it?
Because of the oral effect that it creates, that's all. The oral effect that this gamaka creates gives that sense of heaviness. And it's quite amazing actually, if you try and think of why one movement should give a different perception. This gamaka is crucial to anything sounding Carnatic or anything sounding non-Carnatic. Or those ragas that you would call Carnatic ragas, those ragas that you would call non-Carnatic. And this gamakam is one of the major reasons why people from other cultures find it very difficult to in fact listen to our music. This gamakam is the reason. Because this gamakam does not purely touch all the swaras. It is everywhere in between. If you ask me to actually tell me what it is, I can't. I can only sing it and show you. You can probably see it on a graph. Actually, I have a graph of three kamikams. They're all different. They're all different. They're not the same. On the same swara. On the same swara. Physically, I can show ma, all sabhikam. I sang three varieties of rhythm. You ask me where I went, I don't know, but I know how it should sound. You ask me where it is exactly, I don't know. But by that ma, I know how it should sound. And I'm saying this specifically because when you go to raga, this is a very, very important aspect. How should it sound? Being a very, very important aspect. Any questions here?
Yeah, in this particular gamaka, the artist won't breathe, they do it in one breath. And then
I lost you.
Usually
in one breath.
Because the other ones, you can.
Because it's a continuous, you can't break it. No, but even you sing ma, I can't connect it. Ma, pani, has to be one breath. I can't break it. See, when the gamaka is actually being sung, there is no break in it. It has to be sung as one breath. The important aspects to remember in a gamaka is that it covers, it's a, first of all, a movement, okay? And it also does not have a break. And it is not just about, reaching, touching few frequencies or other swaras. It is not about that. It is about, I'm not using the word augmentation. It is about the effect that movement creates as a melody. It is about the effect that movement creates as a melody that defines the gamaka.